For me, one of the biggest challenges has always been, how do I show up in a way that's authentic for me? The online space is a little bit performative. Well, it's a lot performative, right? And so people talk about, you need to be authentic. What does that mean? And so for me, it's like, you know, how do I show up in a way that feels really good for me? That is going to be the challenge always, is can you be fully yourself, and can you allow yourself to be super vulnerable in doing that? Like, I don't think people talk enough about how vulnerable it is to show up online and sell your things and share your thoughts and your beliefs. So for me, that's always a big challenge. We all have failure. And I would say the biggest challenge is in entrepreneurship across the board for anybody is going to be, how do you adapt from failure? Do you let it knock you out completely? Or do you let it course correct you into, you know, a little bit, getting a little closer where you want to be?
Hello, Laura. Welcome to the Master Delegator Podcast. I'm so excited to have you as a guest on Master Delegator because you have some great insights about, you know, running a business and also marketing strategies that you'd love to share to our audience. So before we dig deeper, please introduce yourself.
Hi, Chrissy. Thank you so much for having me on the show. I'm so excited to be here. I always love an opportunity to chat with new people and new audiences. I'm so grateful for this, and I cannot wait to pour in. But for those that are meeting me for the first time, you're like, who's Laura Sinclair? I am based out of Toronto, Canada. I am an online marketing and business mentor. I mentor early stage female founders, help them get their businesses seen. I have a background in public relations and social media, and so found myself in the online space after a somewhat, what feels like a lot, a bit of a roller coaster up and down in my life and career, and did a lot of really cool things. Found myself in the online space at the beginning of 2021 and started my business helping people with social media marketing. And then over the years, now I'm in a place where I own a social media marketing agency called the LJ Social Agency. I have a podcast called This Mother Means Business. I also have a community called This Mother Means Business for entrepreneurial mothers. And I do mentorship and consulting in a one-on-one way or through my mastermind. So I have a lot of different things that I have going on, but really what I'm about is helping female business owners get their businesses in front of new audiences.
Wow, that is awesome. So you run three businesses, right? And you are a mom.
Yeah.
And that's not easy. I don't have kids yet. I have a dog, so I think he's considered our child. and I delegate, you know, I have team members who does marketing and pretty much anything that I don't want to do, you know, and I'm not good at. So I delegate those things to them. But this morning I was checking my calendar and I noticed that I have been doing a lot of meetings. I've been doing a lot of one-on-one networking with people that I got connected with on Instagram, Threads, you know, we met on Threads, and I have people that I got connected with from LinkedIn as well. And I was like talking to myself. I do self-talk a lot. And I was like talking to myself. I was like, Christy, you are already delegating, but yet your calendar is like 60 to 70% full. How much more if you are not delegating? And I'm saying that because, you know, I don't have kids yet. How much more if I have kids already? Like, I wonder how my calendar is going to look like. So you have three businesses, and I don't know how many kids you have, but even if you only have one kid, you know, I feel like that's enough to be busy. So you have two. So how do you manage your schedule?
Yeah, it's a lot. And you know what? I love what you said about, you know, you feel like you're delegating already, and but then it's like, oh, you know, my calendar is already 60 or 70% full. I feel like it's really a flux. And I'm going to tell you a story in a second about something that I had to realize recently. But for me, a lot of it is just like accepting that there's a lot, I think there's a lot of ego in delegation, to be honest.
Right.
Where we as a business owner hold on to way too much, right? We're like, well, I'm the owner. I started this thing. I'm the best at it. And nobody's better than me. And so we hold on to it, right? Like, there's this need that we like want to be wanted. We need to be the needed person, especially as female entrepreneurs, I think. And so for me, it's like just letting go of some of that ego stuff, which I've had to do in my agency over the years, where it's been like, wow, I really do this thing, but I got to let it go to this person. And then I try it and they're way better at it than I am. So I've had that happen to me a few times, but really a lot of it is like accepting where you are most needed. And for me, I can delegate everything but being my children's mother. And so like when I look at the grand scheme of like what it is that I have to do, what it is that I'm doing, that is always going to be the most important task, if we want to call it that. And so really just accepting like, okay, what is a actual CEO task here? And what is the task that I should be giving to somebody else? And really having that like good, hard look through it. And the story I want to share with you is I was a person that if you had asked me in like February of this year, if I was crushing delegation, I would have been like, yeah, I've got it. And I'm not just talking my business, like business and life, right? Like there are,
right.
There are things that we need to delegate. You know, I have someone that cleans my home.
Exactly.
I have a child who's in school, and I have one that's in daycare. So there's elements of childcare that I've outsourced in my life. But in March, I broke my leg. And so I'm, you know, as we're recording this, about 12 weeks out from breaking my leg.
So and I'm sorry to hear that.
No, I'm fine. But the story is that, you know, there's a point to this, me sharing this, is that I couldn't drive. Lost the ability to drive. I have two small children, a shift working husband, and three businesses. And so I found myself in this situation where I was like, oh, actually, Laura, you thought you were delegating enough. You thought you were asking for help, and you really weren't. And you weren't to the full capacity of your ability to ask for help because people started stepping up, right? This happened to me. Hey, can I drive your daughter to school? Hey, can I make food for you? Hey, can I help you in this way? And so for me, it's really opened my eyes even recently to look at, okay, where am I still holding on to things? And this is an invitation for anyone that's listening, like really get real with yourself. It's like, what if you were to break your leg, which I hope you don't do, I don't wish it on anyone, but like if you were to be actually incapacitated for a little while, like are there people in your life that you can delegate things to? And if you can, I would encourage you to do that so the universe doesn't break your leg that you have to figure it out.
Right. Wow. That is so good. And I think for most entrepreneurs, they don't realize that delegation also applies to their personal life, you know, because I'm like that too, you know. Before I was like, no, do everything. But then I don't like mowing,
yeah,
you know, so I asked my husband to do that and he's doing that every day. I don't like taking care of trash every week, so he's doing that.
Yeah.
I don't like vacuuming, so I got a robot vacuum, and we have a dog. He's a golden retriever, so he sheds a lot.
Yeah, I bet.
And weeds are growing everywhere outside our house, so I was thinking of doing the mulch and pulling out weeds, but it's hot outside, and I was like, I just don't want to do it, you know. And just today, 30 minutes before we do this interview, I was talking to somebody who's gonna do our yard. So I was like, I'm glad there are people out there who can help, you know.
I'm carting my groceries. My groceries are on their way to our house right now as we have this conversation.
I love it. I love it. And then starting last year too, because I love to cook.
Yeah.
But not when I'm busy with, you know, my business, you know, because we only have, so I take a break between 12 to 1, and I don't want to cook between 12 to 1. You know, I just want to eat and relax, you know, free up my brain. And so I came across this company online, and this is not sponsored, this, you know, by this company. It's, you have probably seen their ads on Facebook or Instagram. It's called Factor. Okay. So we order from them every week. So they send meals to us. All we do is put them in the fridge, and then when we're ready to eat, pop them in the microwave for 2 minutes, and then that's it. We eat, and then stress-free, right? So there are a lot of things we can do as a business owner to free up, you know, our time. And I feel like for the most part, it's not even the time that's the problem, you know, because we only have 24 hours, you know, a day, and we should already accept that. I think what we need to free up mostly is our brain space, you know, because if your brain is cluttered with stress and unnecessary things that you're doing or that you're thinking about, you won't be able to function as a business owner. So when you started your business, did you have kids yet or not yet?
So if we back up a little bit, I became an entrepreneur in 2015. So I've been an entrepreneur for almost 10 years. And my first business was actually a gym. And so I ran a brick and mortar CrossFit gym here in Ontario, Canada. And
you know what? I can actually see that. You have that gym type of, you know, countenance in you.
So we had that. And so I owned the gym before I had children. And then my daughter was born when I owned the gym during that season. And then my son was born in 2020. So I have a pandemic baby. And we owned the gym at the time and ended up closing the gym at the end of 2020. So when the world shut down for 2 weeks out of an abundance of caution, I was 8 weeks pregnant. And we decided at the end of 2020 to close the gym. We sold off all of our equipment. And then I ended up in the online space just shortly after. So December 2020 is when the gym closed. And then February of 2021 is when I first kind of started showing up. So at that point, I had a 3-month-old baby and a 3.5-year-old daughter.
Wow. Kudos to you. And now you are, you know, you are passionate about helping, you know, other moms out there be successful in terms of growing their business through social media marketing. So what made you decide to have a business instead of, you know, working for somebody else?
Yeah, so I have a, you know, I worked in corporate marketing for 10 years. And so I was always a really, looking back on it, like I was a bad employee. You know, I think that people are either wired to be entrepreneurs or they're wired to work for somebody else. And I don't think that, like, one's not better than the other. But when I think about, you know, my time in corporate, I never really stayed at a job for more than 3 years. I always bounced around. I was always looking for the next thing. I asked a lot of questions, you know, like process for processing. I worked for a German automotive company for a while. And I was like, why are we doing so much process? I don't like it. I worked at marketing agencies that were really nimble, and that I really loved. But for me, like I choose entrepreneurship, and there have been lots of times where I could have chose something else, or, you know, certainly when I left my corporate job, I knew that going back to corporate was always an option for me. I mean, I have a marketing background, I have an extensive background, worked on a lot of cool things. I'm still very well connected in the marketing space here in Canada. And so that would always be an option for me. But I choose entrepreneurship because of freedom. And you talked about this earlier, is brain space. And when I talk about freedom, I'm not just talking about time freedom, which is what people are, location freedom, which people talk about. For me, it's freedom of my mind. It's freedom for me to, like, create what I want to create, to think what I want to think, to try things on in a way that is going to allow me to learn and grow and teach other people about it, rather than, you know, filling out the form and doing the box and pushing the paper the way that it was supposed to be done. Because even as a corporate marketer, you know, I worked for, my last job in corporate marketing was for a German automotive company, luxury automotive company, and you're still getting, like, the marketing materials coming over from Germany, and then you're, like, adapting it for Canada, and it's like you're not really getting to play in the same way that you get to play as an entrepreneur. And so entrepreneurship gives me the ability to just create and dream and, you know, live in my own head with my own thoughts and my own ideas, and rather than doing it for somebody else.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Are you sick and tired of being overwhelmed and afraid you'll never scale your business? Meet Smart VAs. Unlike many virtual assistant agencies that only assign one dedicated virtual assistant, we provide flexibility for growing businesses by assigning a team of experienced virtual assistants that can do different tasks to support your continuous growth. Visit smartvas.online to book a free discovery call and start growing your business.
Tell me about a challenge in your business that was very difficult for you, and how did you overcome that?
Oh gosh, there's been so many, so many. And I think that if you're a business owner and you don't have challenges, then you're probably not trying anything new. And so I would challenge you to move that. I think, you know, for me, one of the biggest challenges has always been, you know, how do I show up in a way that's authentic for me? Right. I think
I
a lot of
that.
People do this. And the online space is a little bit performative. Well, it's a lot performative, right? And so people talk about, you need to be authentic. What does that mean? And so for me, it's like, you know, how do I show up in a way that feels really good for me? And for anybody that's listening, I would challenge you to, you know, think about that for yourself too. It's like, that is going to be the challenge always is, can you be fully yourself and can you allow yourself to be super vulnerable in doing that? Like, I don't think people talk enough about how vulnerable it is to show up online and sell your things and share your thoughts and your beliefs. And so for me, that's always a big challenge. But I think, you know, you want a specific challenge, I think, like, failure, right? It's like, it's all, we all have failure. And I would say the biggest challenge is in entrepreneurship across the board for anybody is going to be, how do you adapt from failure? Do you let it knock you out completely? Or do you let it course correct you into, you know, a little bit, getting a little closer where you want to be?
Yeah, that's so true. And I love when you said about, you know, how do you show up authentically? And even if you show up authentically, is that even authentic? Yeah. You know, are you like showing authentically just because you want to be authentic? But if you want to force yourself to be authentic, then that's not authentic. You know what I mean? Yeah. So we all have our own definition of being authentic. And of course, failure. That's the hardest thing of being an entrepreneur, right? You test things, and if it doesn't work out, then, you know, it's normal to feel bad, you know, but just always, you know, think that, you know, who's that guy who invented the light bulb? I don't know his name, but he said something like this, like, you did not fail 1,000 times, whatever. You just found a way, you just found 1,000 ways that, you know, that didn't work, something like that. Don't quote me on that, but that's the same thought.
Yeah, I mean, entrepreneurship is a series of failures, as is motherhood,
right?
Which is like, yeah, that I always try to talk to moms about, right? It's like with your kid, when you're trying to like learn how to be a quote unquote good mom, or like you're getting it wrong until you get it right.
Right, exactly. Oh.
Right? Like you're constantly getting things wrong. That's the only way to get it right. Like nobody starts a business and it's just like, well, nailing it. This is so easy. I'm doing everything right. I haven't made a single mistake. Like, no, the only way that you learn, the only way that you get better, the closer to where you want to go is by making mistakes and messing it up. And so if you can learn that and be okay with the fact that messing it up is just part of the process, then that's okay.
Yeah, that is so true. Yeah, even with, you know, with parenting, right? Again, I'm not a parent yet, but I have a lot of parent friends. So I learned from them. And there's this one friend that told me, you know what, when I had my first baby, I wanted to have my second child already because I kind of want to correct the mistakes I made on my first baby. But then the second one came and I still make a lot of mistakes. So she's like, you know, I was wrong to think that my first baby and my second baby are going to be totally the same, but they have different personalities. And so she said, my approach with the first baby, I thought it's going to work with the second baby, but it's not. Yes.
Yeah. My first baby was a great eater. She slept really well. I didn't really have she was a menace in other ways, but she did some things that was like, she was a great sleeper. She ate really well. She wasn't up early. And I had such an ego about it. Like I was so like, how hard, like, why is it so hard to get your picky eater to eat? Like just, that's all you give them. Don't make them 7 other meals. And then, you know, same thing. It's like, oh, well, if your kid's up at 5, just put them back to sleep. Like, what do you mean? It's not that hard. And then my son comes along and he's the worst eater. He loves 5 a.m. And it's like, okay, thank you, universe, for giving me that ego check where it's like, I thought that I had it all figured out and I did not.
Yeah. I mean, no, there is no way we can figure out everything in this world, you know? No. Yeah. So tell me about your opinion or your experience when it comes to delegating effectively, and how do you think an entrepreneur can have freedom and flexibility in their business?
Yeah, I love that you asked this. So there's a couple of things. I work with a lot of solopreneurs. I work with a lot of people that have built their business. A lot of people come to me having built their business entirely by themselves, and they're feeling this sort of like you were talking about at the beginning. Like, oh my gosh, my calendar is so full. I can't possibly take on more. I want to scale. I want to make more money, but I am stuck. And usually we're having that first conversation around, okay, we need to delegate. We need to hire some help for you. We need to, you know, find somebody to take this off your plate. And so usually for me, like I like to look at really building out a whole list of tasks, right? Like, what is it that you're actually doing in your day? And then assigning dollar amounts to those tasks. right? Like, what do you want to make as a business owner? Let's say it's $100 an hour or $700 an hour, whatever it is. I'm willing to bet that there's a lot of things on your list that are probably $20 an hour tasks or $15 an hour tasks. They're not $200 an hour tasks. And so it starts with looking at, okay, what are the tasks that are lower cost tasks that are easier for me to delegate, right? And what are the things that, you know, aren't necessarily mission critical that are not CEO tasks either. And so for me, in my own experience with delegation has been A, like looking at that, B, getting over my ego, which is I mentioned earlier, right? That like, well, I'm the best at it. Like, no, you're not. There's other people that are way better at it than you. Just find them and let them. And then the third part is, you know, really being able to empower the people that you're delegating to, and not, you can't expect people to read your mind, but how can you empower them to delegate like in the task that they're doing, and letting them have some autonomy around it? I think those have been three really big ones for me.
That is so good. I love when you said that, you know, don't expect your team members to read your minds.
Oh.
Because, you know, even us, we don't know our own thoughts, right? How do you expect somebody to read your mind?
Yeah, and delegating at first can feel like work. You know, people will say, mm-hmm. you know, like I hired this VA or this OBM and they're not like, I don't know what to give them. It's like, well, have you talked to them? Like, are you just assuming that they're going to just like read your mind? Like, no, as a CEO, as a founder, it is your job to equip them with what it is that they need. And it can feel like work at first, right? Because you're having to create the SOPs or, you know, one of the things I love to do if I'm handing off a task is to just record a Loom video of myself actually doing the task and speaking over it. Like, you know, here's where I'm clicking. Here's how I'm making this happen. And creating a library of videos for my team so that it's like when Laura is asking me to do XYZ thing, it's right here in the video. And then they can, you know, if they want to make notes from it, they can do that however they want to learn. But I think people don't realize sometimes that delegating at first still requires a fair amount of work. And it's easy right. to get caught in that trap. That's like, oh, I'm just going to do it myself because it's faster. Maybe in the short term, but in the long term, it's not.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, recording yourself, how you do things, you know, using Loom to record your screen so you can walk through a VA to create a process for the VA. Even the idea of that for some people, it feels very overwhelming already. But sometimes, you know, when I was beginning to delegate, I felt like that. But then I realized, you know, when I started recording using Loom, I realized that, you know, it only took me 10 minutes to do it.
Yeah.
And then I was
anyway, like record it while you're going to go do the task. So you're
right. Kind of like
two birds, one stone sort of situation.
Exactly. And then it only took me 10 minutes, but it took me about 2 days to complain, worry about doing the Loom video. I had anxiety about, you know, was very anxious about doing it, you know, but I think you just have to get over it, you know, and do it, because after you record yourself working or walking through the VA, you know, you are relieved of doing that task sort of forever, you know, because you've delegated it. Yeah, I love it. So I know we can talk, you know, all day about delegation, and I love talking to you. But as we wrap up, where can people find you? And would you mind, or if you want, you can share some promotions that you have.
Sure. Yeah. So the easiest place to find me is on Instagram or Threads, because I love Threads, and I'm so glad that you and I
love Threads. I love Threads.
My favorite is my favorite place to play, because I posted a thread actually. I don't know what, like, I was an ex-Twitter user, so it's like I posted a thread, I threaded a thread. I don't know what the lingo is exactly, but I love so much about it that I can just like think something and then post it. I don't have to make a graphic or a video or anything. It's just very, works really well for my train of thought. But I'm on Meta platforms at It's Laura Sinclair. So if you've made it this far, feel free to send me a thread or a DM or follow along. I share all kinds of information around building your business, being seen, marketing, visibility, and motherhood. We have a lot of conversations about motherhood over in my world. And if you want to learn more about my community, so if you are a mom entrepreneur who's looking to connect with other mom entrepreneurs, you should absolutely check out my podcast, This Mother Means Business, which you can listen to anywhere that you listen to podcasts. And I also have a community called This Mother Means Business. And we have a monthly mastermind call. There are networking calls twice a month. And I bring in some really incredible guests to help you build your business and be supported as a mom building business, because it's just not the same with love, right? Building a business when you have the responsibilities of also having children is totally different. It's a whole other game than somebody that doesn't have that. Even though I'm sure your baby is amazing. I have two also, but I've done it both ways. And so
it's definitely different. Yeah.
Different. So thismothermeansbusiness.com is the place where you can find out all things podcast, all things community, and you can also join one of our networking calls. So if you want to come and just get a sense of the vibe, if you head to thismothermeansbusiness.com, you can join our networking calls. I'd love to see you there.
Wow, I love it. Well, it's a pleasure talking to you today, Laura. I'm excited to get this episode out there. You shared some really great insights, and let's keep in touch.
Peace.